Hey guys, I just thought that this sunset was really, really pretty. It has all the really deep purples and grays and lavender and such. You know, Jesus said to the Pharisees that, you know, a wicked and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign, but none will be given to them other than the sign of Jonah. And then he walked away. And right before that, he had said, you know, you say that when it's red skies at night, it's going to be pleasant because the sky's red. And then you say in the morning that when you see the sky red, that it's going to be storms and bad weather because the sky is lowering in red. And he said, you hypocrites, you can discern the face of the sky and you can't see the signs of the time. And that's the same thing that's going on now. It's just, you know, even when the triumphal entry took place and Jesus came through on the donkey and there were many that lined the streets there in Jerusalem, waving their palm branches, saying, Hosanna in the highest, and calling him Messiah. And yet he wept at the gates of Jerusalem. And he had said, you know, oh Israel, how many times that I'd wanted to gather you, you know, under my wing like a hen gathers her chicks. And you would not. And sorry, my dogs are kind of, as usual, fighting on the deck and playing, guys. Guys. Anyway. Guys, it's one of those things where people either see it or they don't. He wept because they didn't know the time of their appointment. They should have known exactly. You know, even to where Daniel... had prophesied his entry, that he would come through on that very day on a donkey. He said, yay, I say a donkey's colt, basically. And they should have known. It should have been more than just a couple of thousand or however many there were. It, really, all of Israel should have shown up, or anyone who considered themselves to be a Jew or knew the prophecies and the scriptures. They should have known. And they should have known. Well, I don't want to say it past tense because it hasn't happened yet, but it'll be the same way now. You know, he said it would be like in the days of Noah where people would be eating and drinking and marrying and giving in marriage, and just like in the days of Lot where they were building and buying and selling, and they basically didn't know what hit them until, you know, the flood came and took them all away in Noah's case, or when Noah and his family were safe on the ark, or didn't know what hit him until the fire and brimstone started raining down from heaven, the very moment, basically, that Lot and his two daughters were escaping out of the city, because his wife even turned back. And he tried to tell, you know, all of his household. He tried to tell his son-in-laws, you know, and they kind of scoffed at him. Oh, you know, what are you drunk tonight, or what's going on with you? I mean, like, they didn't believe, guys, and it's the same thing now. Those who will believe do, and those who don't can't discern the face of the sky. They can't see the signs of the times, and they can't see what's coming, and they should know the time of their appointment, just like back then, because Daniel had told them, even to the day, that will be your Messiah come through on the donkey. But the very same ones that claimed to know or said Hosanna in the highest to him and recognized him as Mashiach, many of them turned away at the next moment and were denying him by saying crucify him in that same angry crowd. There were many that of the same people there. So even seeing is not believing to some. But I say, you know, like that we walk by faith, and the Bible says that too, and one day our faith soon will be sight, just like the old hymn says, you know, and God hates the day that our faith will be sight, the sky will be rolled back as a scroll. The Lord shall descend and the trump will sound, even so it is well with my soul. And it is, guys, it's well with us. It's a bittersweet time, and we're trying to call out to a lost and dying world, and even to those in the church, you know, to wake up to what time it is. But I believe that anyone that's a born-again Christian that's born of his Holy Spirit will rise on that day. If you've got his Holy Spirit, you're going to go in the rapture. He's not going to leave his born-again believers here. And, you know, albeit they might be a little dismayed that we're, or actually probably pleasantly surprised that we're going up that soon, you know, because they might be a little confused at first, but it wouldn't take a split second to realize that's Jesus and the angels and we're going up, guys. It's going to be a beautiful thing, guys. It really will. But just realize that, you know, just because most people are in unbelief and they won't really hear and it's going to fall on deaf ears now, keep planting seeds in truth because, you know, that's going to make all the difference later during the tribulation, because it's not going to be like Sodom and Gomorrah where the fire and brimstone will rain down and the whole, all of them will be destroyed, or where the flood came and swept them all away. In the case of the Great Tribulation, there will be some that, and many actually, that will get a chance. And there will be millions upon millions dying from all different kinds of things, pestilence and plagues and famine and war and all these things too. But the ones that are given a chance to repent, the ones that, that Jesus chose, you know, from the foundation of the world. And, you know, we don't know necessarily who is and who isn't. That's up to Jesus. But many of the seeds that we're planting now, that they will take to heart and know exactly what happened the moment that we're gone. They'll run down to their nursery and the four-year-old is gone or the baby's gone. And it's going to make all the difference, guys. They'll scramble for our messages then, as to where it's easy to discard them now and say, you know what, most of the world doesn't believe the devil exists or God. They don't have the faith enough to believe any of that now. But perhaps if we get on out of here and they look for us, but we are no more, just like Enoch, because the Lord has taken us. Because I don't really think that they will all hear the trumpet. I think that just us believers will. Then very possibly that they'll have the faith enough then to believe that it's all true. And I've heard it said before, you know, like what would cause somebody that today kind of mocks and scoffs and says, oh, well, that couldn't really be happening. You know, there really isn't, you know, God or Jesus or anything like that. And then what could make them line up themselves and their wives and their 17-year-old son, let's say, at the guillotine and be willing to die and lose their head for Jesus 3 or 4 months later or 2 or 3 years later or whatever? Because it seems as if, you know, like in the very first part, I think that they will have a chance to be able to line up, and I think they will in droves to accept the mark. And then there will come a time when it will be demanded of them either to denounce Jesus and to deny his name or to accept the mark. And I think that many will make the right decision in that day and be with us and join us in the kingdom later. So, guys, I love you, and I hope there wasn't too much distractions for my dogs and everything. And for those of you who joined the live stream today, thank you so much. And just know that these are our times to watch. And, you know, we're not going to be like, you know, Jesus doesn't have to weep for us. And we just weep for the ones who don't know right now. And that's because we have the mind of Christ. You know, just like Paul says, we can feel his pain too. We share in the sufferings of Christ, and we know. So guys, I think it's rather appropriate that the sirens are going off, because this may be one of the last warnings that people get before we're out of here. Y'all have a good night, and if I don't see you back here, I'll see you around the throne. Talk to y'all soon.